So today I would like to talk nuclear physics techniques which can help for cultural heritage studies. There are many of them, but let's see essentially what is most important to say. So some few slides about the techniques, some results and application. Then I would like to talk about dating objects with radiocarbon measurements. And then I would like to spend some time on a new tool, which is an hopefully portable accelerator, which would profit many museum in the world. I mean, things that you have a country with many museums, you cannot hope to get the money, the funds for equipping all the museums with an accelerator. But if you would have in the country one portable accelerator, then probably that would be the best for exploiting the ion beam analysis technique. So let me talk about what we are talking essentially. If you shoot a beam of particles, protons or alpha particles, ions in general, then with an accelerator, then you excite nuclei from the different elements, components that you find on the surface or a bit in depth of an art object, a painting or a sculpture or whatever best you want. Then essentially what you do is that you excite the level nuclear levels, they get back to their fundamental state with an emission typically of X-rays, and studying those X-rays you get essentially the fingerprint of what you have shoot your beam on. Okay, so essentially this is a way to understand perfectly the material composition of the art object that you want to explore and better understand. So this is another way. If you want, you kick out one electron from the orbit, and you get an X-ray which corresponds to the maximum energy you can get out, and that's essentially another fingerprint of the object that you are examining. So what you need is, in principle, something that produces protons and ions and some detector that measure precisely the energy of X-rays which are emitted. Okay, so essentially this is what the entire landscape of what you can do. Of course, you can scatter on a nucleus, you can scatter on an electron, you emit photons or hard photons, or you want to you can get backscattered particles, you can get an X-ray emission. All of them are can be measured if you are able to, and they help in identifying the components that you want to identify. Okay, now the technique is very powerful. Essentially, you can analyze most of the elements that you can think that your art masterpiece is made of. You can detect scanning through. You can detect all the elements. It's non-destructive, it's non-invasive, no damage. So if somebody wants to examine a Leonardo painting or a Picasso painting, they'll give it to you, you measure it, you give back the certification of what is made of, and they can re-put the painting in the same place as it was before without any change in the object. It's a quantitative analysis. It says how much of each element you have, and that's a very good sensitivity. So it can spot even tiny, tiny amount of specific pigments or specific materials that were used in crafting the object. Of course, since you can get into beyond the first layer, beyond what you see with your eyes, you can also look behind. So you can even discover if the painting was recycled, say, or if there were change of mind of the painter. So it's an interesting way of understanding the evolution of the painting, or history, if you want, of that specific painting. And of course you have a spatial resolution which corresponds to the size of your bean spot, which can be as small as you reasonably can achieve. Now, for example, in Italy...
Fernando, you are changing your slides, we don't see it. We are stuck on slide one. Are you changing slide yet?
I've changed many slides, that's the problem.
Okay, so it looks like we need to fix the...
Wait a moment. We need to fix it. We fix it. Okay. Let me share again the screen. So this you see, right?
Yes. Yes.
And now, do you see?
We see that. Huh? Yes.
Okay. So the problem was in the play. Mode, but I think I can go with this modality.
Yeah.
So that was the description in general terms of what ion beam analysis means. Okay, so you shoot particles on your art piece that you want to examine. This is how it works essentially. The protons or the ions or the alpha particle scatters on the nuclei of the component of the sample you are analyzing, and they excite most of the time they excite the levels, the nuclear levels, and this excitation you get radiation out of it, X-rays, gammas. And those you can compare with a table of known transitions, and you know which kind of elements you have, you are probing. So this is essentially again the same concept where each element has a set of X-rays which is peculiar to that element. So this is broadly what you do. You can have X-ray emission, you can have gamma ray emission, you can have inelastic scattering of your probe on target, you can have backscattering, so you can have all sorts of things. So the issue is in getting an entire set of detectors around the point that you are examining for getting the relevant information. So what I was saying is that this technique is non-destructive, non-invasive. It doesn't damage the sample. So it's a great thing to examine art and masterpieces. So one thing I said is that, of course, since your probe have the ability of, according to energy, to pass the first layer, you can even get an idea of what is behind the first layer. So essentially, if the painting has been redone, if there are things that have been changed, or restored or something like that. So, and the sensitivity, the spatial sensitivity, is very high because you can essentially it matches the dimension of the of your beam. One example of a center where these things are done is in Florence. Of course, Italy is a privileged country from the point of view of cultural heritage. We have plenty of museums and other things that are worth to be examined or restored. So it makes perfect sense that INFN, which is the National Institute for Nuclear Physics, has set up a center dedicated to cultural heritage analysis. And then, not by chance, it is made in Florence, which is one of the art cities, most important art cities in Italy. Okay, but I mean, there are other places in Europe and the world where these things are done. And this is important because you see, this is a 3 megavolt accelerator, okay? So this is able to shoot 3 megavolt, 3 MeV particles, protons, on your masterpiece, art masterpiece. As you see, the problem is that it's a big object, okay? It takes an entire hall. Which is nothing wrong. I mean, it's not the whole space which is the problem. The problem is that if you want to examine something with this accelerator, you have to bring your painting or your sculpture or whatever you are examining, your sample, you have to bring it there. Okay? Now, again, in principle, there is nothing wrong. But I mean, somehow you don't feel so much confident in taking a painting that is worth a few hundred million euro, I think, in dollars, I think, to a Leonardo or whatever. And I mean, you detach from the wall of your museum, you put in your car and you bring it there. And so you see, there are a lot of complications in this process. So, although this is a very important center for doing these studies, here immediately you understand that you would like to have something portable rather than such a big object. The problem is that having a 3 megavolt accelerator or few megavolt accelerator portable is not something very easy. Okay, so what you do in a laboratory like this, is essentially all the ion beam analysis that you can think of. So you can measure the X-rays. You can have all the connected possible activities. You have ion beam analysis. You can do essentially the tomography of the painting. That depends on the speed that you can have to scan the entire surface of your painting, for example, or your sculpture. And of course, you can assign a date to the object according to the radiocarbon technique that I'm going to describe soon. So you see, for example, this is an example of what you could do. For example, analyzing the writings of a letter of Galileo Galilei, which is important because that helps in the reconstruction of when this letter was written, okay? Because you compare the ink composition here with because this piece of paper has no date, okay? So you don't know when Galileo has written this letter. Of course, this is not a direct measurement, but you compare essentially the ink composition of this letter with something, with all the inks that you can get from other documents which have a date on top. So the one which is most similar give you the date of the document. This is one example of creativity in using this technique analysis, okay? This is essentially the tool that you are using. So the beam gets into the ink and the back products, the back scattered products get into the probe. This is just a collection of things that have been done in this using this accelerator in long times. So not only letters, but also sculptures or very famous paintings. And all this has been done to the ion beam analysis. Well, now one thing that you can do, you see, for example, you take this painting, and you want to understand which elements have been used into the pigments. So you see that you can go into very, very tiny details. So you can get essentially an analysis which corresponds to millimeter square, okay? So at that point, you know precisely in that millimeter square, if this is there is some gold, or there is some lead, or there is some silicon, or aluminum, or iron, tin, potassium, or whatever. This is important not only to understand the technical ability, the use of the materials that were available, the technology that was available in the 15th century, but also if you ever want to restore this painting, then you can, if you want, use precisely the same pigment. Now, when I said that it's very important to have a portable equipment, of course you have portable equipment, but portable equipment are X-rays, okay? So you can generate X-rays essentially with portable equipment. So what you cannot to date produce with a portable equipment are few MeV protons, okay? So, however, you see that already with these tools, you do a lot of things. Okay, this is another way to look at how many detectors are around the painting that you are examining, trying to collect as much as possible of the back products of the scattering of the particles that you shoot on the painting from the beam. Okay, this is another example of something which has been done with portable equipment, and more you see that of course in a country like Italy you don't miss of masterpieces to examine, and many people want to understand mostly for understanding whether restoration of the painting is doable, is possible, it's worth to make it. But this is not limited to paintings or to sculpture. As I said, one was essentially dating through the analysis of the ink the Galileo's papers, but other authors, if you want. Not well, when I say dating papers through the analysis of the ink, I'm not saying that has to do with the radiocarbon analysis. This is completely different thing. You cannot assess the age of the ink with radiocarbon. We are on the way, but it's not done. In fact, if you take this object, which I call Artemidorus papyrus, this is an interesting puzzle, okay? Because there is a long-standing fight between people studying those documents of that period, not physicists actually, human scientists, and they still are fighting by in deciding whether this papyrus is a fake or it's original. Now, here it comes at the contradiction of what you do, because, for example, with radiocarbon, you can easily measure the support, the papyrus itself, which is a vegetable, but you cannot date the ink. So by now, we know that the papyrus is original. I mean, it's compatible with when the Artemidorus was alive, 2000 years ago. But this doesn't prevent the people fighting over it and saying, okay, fine, so that they got a fresh papyrus from that period and they wrote on it with a modern ink. We are on the way of solving this mystery, but has not been done. However, one part of the mystery has been solved. Okay. Leonardo masterpieces have been analyzed by the ion beam analysis. Even Japanese katanas have been analyzed by X-ray spectroscopy, deciding whether this was an original katana eventually restored or is a modern one. Analysis of tissues has been done, finding that there are frogs or pillows that are compatible, for example, with time when Saint Francis of Assisi was alive. And then at a point, I will tell you about discovering even forgeries of modern art by using the byproducts of the nuclear explosion of the 60 years, sixth decade of the last century. So it's time probably to go to a description of the radiocarbon method. The method has to do with the fact that every living body, whether a vegetable or an animal, absorb carbon from the air, and this carbon has a definite ratio of the isotopes, which are essentially due to the fact that in atmosphere you produce the isotopes of carbon through irradiation by cosmic rays. The point is that when a plant or an animal dies, then there is no longer an absorption of carbon, fresh carbon. So at that point, the carbon, which is radioactive, starts to decay. And so it alters with time the proportion between the radioactive carbon and the main stable carbon. So at that point, you can, with the precision you are able to, you can decide what the age of that remnants of that body was. And this is an easy to say, more difficult to do. For example, you want to keep some precision. You don't want to know whether things has been done 5,000 years ago or 6,000 years ago. I mean, especially with objects that correspond to the history of humankind, it's important to know whether it was from 700 before Common Era or 600 before Common Era. It's important to decide the level of civilization in one part of the world. Now you have to know that, for example, the uncertainty on the measurement is every half a percent, 5 per mil of error on the concentration induce a 40 years errors on the date you can assess. Of course, accelerator mass spectrometry used to assess the number, but you have to work, I mean, if you could work with 1 kilogram of the element of the sample, you would probably measure better, but it's difficult that somebody that possess the very precious object want to remove a large part of it for giving to you for analysis. So typically the analysis is done with 1 milligram or so of the material. However, a sensitivity down to 10 to minus 15 has been reached with the mass spectrometry analysis. So this means that you can go back to essentially 50,000 years, which is not bad, but is not, for example, you cannot use a radiocarbon for understanding whether the bones of some primitive hominid found in Africa or somewhere else are from, I don't know, half a million years ago or 2 million years ago. That radiocarbon is not the good technique for those measurements. Radiocarbon is an extremely powerful tool for dating every object which has been produced by human civilization in the last 5,000 years, I say, okay? However, normally, as I said, the application of carbon 14, which is the isotope that decays, are used for dating archaeological findings, okay, or historical findings. One application, so this is, as I said, objects that are few hundred years old or a few thousand years old. Many thousands of years old. There is one case, okay, this is the way you want to do. You want to examine, for example, this is the frog of St. Francis in principle. So you get 1 milligram of it and you use it for your analysis, precisely dating things. Here you don't need much of it because this is only 800, 900 years old, in principle. However, in this laboratory, in Florence was called by Guggenheim Museum to try to help in solving one delicate issue, whether paintings of contemporary art was an original or a fake. So this is the painting, okay? This is the painting which was attributed to Fernand Léger and was bought by Guggenheim Museum. Now, here it has been used one interesting thing. You see, this is the radiocarbon concentration in the atmosphere, which was pretty stable until the first atomic bomb, nuclear bomb, was detonated in air, in the atmosphere. So the thing was around 100 part per whatever concentration. So you see that many bombs were detonated in the northern hemisphere. No one was detonated in the southern hemisphere. And so the radiocarbon started to increase and reached, of course, the maximum when the treaty banning the nuclear explosion in atmosphere was put in to force. And from that point on, you can easily see the decay time of the carbon 14. So if you don't know anything about carbon 14 and you don't want to measure it in a laboratory, you take this curve and you can assess what is the lifetime of carbon 14. So you see that even now we are at a level of carbon 14 which is 15% higher, I think I would say, of what was before atomic bomb detonation. So at this point, if you have a modern painting, you can use these things to understand when it was done, because of course it was done on some vegetal support, which has to do with which was extracted essentially from vegetables in a definite period of time. So this is the result. So what was measured essentially was a concentration of 129 part per whatever. And so you see now you superimpose your measurement of 129 over the radiocarbon history. And you see that this is compatible with essentially being done on support canvas, on a canvas that was produced either in 1959 or 1962 or 1979-80. The problem is that the authors of the paintings died in 1955-6. So he couldn't have done it. So that's definitely a fake. So you see that we helped the Guggenheim Museum not to expose something that was clearly a fake. Or perhaps we made them a favor, because now they can expose the thing, saying, okay, this is a fake and we have demonstrated this is a fake by this means. Some publicity also to nuclear physics is never bad. Okay, now let me go into the final part of my talk. As I said, it would be great if we could have an accelerator producing a few MeV particles that we can put on a track, essentially, and move it around the many museums we have in Italy, for example, or the many museums you have in France, or in the many museums you have in many countries in the world. Taking account that the accelerator that we have in Florence, which is in a research laboratory in the University of Florence, and not in a museum, is one example of existing accelerator. There are few of them around the world. But the only museum in the world that has an accelerator inside the museum is the Louvre in Paris, where they have one accelerator in the basement of Louvre, which can do the same analysis that are done in Florence. But also that one is stuck into the basement of the Louvre and cannot be displaced anywhere else. So this is the picture of what eventually will be, but eventually will be soon, because we are at the finishing stage of this project, something that you can transport. So an accelerator, the motivation for having a portable accelerator are many, because you understand that moving the art masterpiece from a museum or a restoration laboratory, most likely where the every museum has a restoration laboratory, so they are used to which is close or connected to the museum, so they are used to transport the art paintings or sculpture into the restoration laboratory, but so it would be nice to have, in fact, the accelerator in the restoration laboratory. But moving outside the physical building of the museum, that becomes expensive, because you had to, first of all, you had to protect the object in the most with most care, and so packing has to be perfect, proof. But then you have to put on a car, and you have to understand that unfortunately the car could have an accident or whatever, so the things that still have to be protected against those things. So it takes time, it takes authorizations, it takes, I don't know, you have to tell police that you are doing that, but if you tell police also those that would like to steal the object will know about this transport. And there are things that you cannot really do. I mean, there are things that are too fragile to move, which are stuck in the place where they are in the museum, or because are on the walls of a church somewhere. Or because the painting is, I don't know, 50 square meters, and then 50 square meters you cannot move from where it is. Frescoes are other objects that you cannot move. So INFN and CERN have started to work on a project which is acronym, the acronym is MACHINA. MACHINA means a movable accelerator for cultural heritage in situ non-destructive analysis. Okay, a little fantasy. The idea is to develop a movable ion beam analysis system. The first produced machine, so the test machine, will end up in Opificio delle Pietre Dure in Florence. Opificio delle Pietre Dure is the restoration laboratory of the Uffizi Museum in Florence, one of the most famous museums in the world. And also because it's a museum where essentially today many ask for help in restoring art masterpieces. But with the idea that it can be moved for in situ measurements, okay? Now, of course, Opificio is interested in things, and they committed to host the machine. They are learning actually how to use, because of course it brings a cost, not the cost of the machine itself. The cost for the machine is covered by the Ministry of Education and Research in Italy, but on one side, and CERN on the other side. But of course, you have to train and you have to train people, and the people you have to pay from the budget of the museum. But they have been very supportive, so this will end up there. And we hope that then, showing how it works, then there will be other museums in the world that might be interesting. So of course, nothing is perfect, so you cannot have a perfect machine, you cannot have a movable machine that does all the things that the huge object that you have seen at the beginning of my talk in the laboratory in Florence can do. However, it's important that it does the most fundamental, it achieves the most fundamental performances that are requested for a proper analysis for understanding and restoring a masterpiece. As I said, this is a joint INFN and CERN project. The concept is very easy. You have a source, then you have to accelerate a bit the particles, and then you inject the particle on a radio frequency quadrupole that brings the particle to the final energy of few MeV, and then you have to complement it with all the detectors that surround the output of the beam, and can get the back products of the analysis. So in principle it's very easy. To do it is a bit more difficult. So this is the idea. This is the idea of how the object will be. And as you see, you have seen here you have the human scale, okay? And so you can understand that this object properly packed can get into a truck, okay, and be moved in case to somewhere else from the place where usually will be stored. So essentially, this is the essence of my talk. The status of the project is that this picture has been taken a few days ago, and this is the how the object that here it was in CERN now is in Florence. Has been transported back to Florence. So you see that it can be done. The transport can happen, and the object looks in good shape. And final test will be done. We have been delayed by something that you understand that has gone into action in the last few months, this COVID disease. But now I think we can start to work full speed on the object with the idea that in spring next year it can be installed in the Uffizi Museum and start to perform the test and then eventually the work. So my message is that as we all believe that cultural heritage is an integral part of human culture, and it's important to understand how these things were done. It's important to preserve these things. It's important eventually to restore these things in a way that you can exhibit them in the museum. So for doing all these things, I think you need status of the art technological equipments to maintain the quality to assess the eventual degradation of these objects. I've shown you the tool that the nuclear physics can provide, and I believe that it is really a fascinating field to work on. To me, probably because at the beginning, when you are a young student, you are motivated strongly by the message that you have to discover it. You have to discover new particles, you have to discover new phenomena, and that's good. I mean, that is something that brings you up to date with the most technologically advanced technologies, and probably where you can even contribute in enhancing, improving the technologies. But then you will understand when you grow old that the application of what you have learned, of your know-how, can benefit the society even in unexpected ways. So this is my message, and I think I'm ready to take questions from you.
Thanks, Fernando. This is very comprehensive. People have questions or comments?
You can raise your hand in sense of the participant list. There is the button raise hand, and then so I can see then who would like to ask questions. Katevi, probably you have to start.
Yes. So I think the machina detector package What is the cost of to package this thing?
Well, it depends. Well, eventually it will depend if you have to produce 5, 10, or 100 of them. Okay, the industrial process will come at that point. I can tell you what has been the cost of this prototype. Say, okay. Mm. So this prototype has been done with something like 2.5, 3 million euro. Mm-hmm. But you know, here you have to do a lot of things that you never did before.
Hmm? Yeah, of course, yes.
Miniaturization. I mean, I believe that if these things can be produced. In small numbers like 10, then you would find some company able to take over the task and assemble it for a bit, not probably not probably three times less, but probably half of that cost.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because here you have to procure materials in small quantities, you see, so the cost gets into, the cost is not representative of what you get at the end. But yeah, if you think at the budget of larger museum, that should be affordable.
Yeah.
I mean, the big museum in Europe or in US or in Asia, are rich enough. Not only, but often you can count on some government, probably grant, for doing this.
Mm-hmm. There is a question from Stefan Nyaranga. Stefan, you want to ask your question?
Do I see it?
Yes, I can ask.
Okay, yes, Stefan.
Are you getting me, all of you?
Yes, please go ahead.
My question is about the AMS, that is accelerator mass spectrometer.
Yeah.
How can we increase its sensitivity? And also,
nice question.
And also the we are told that does the challenges on precision. Eh? So how can it be? How are you coping up with the precision of AMS? Thank you.
Look, the AMS, AMS are essentially state-of-the-art machine that you buy. Most of the precision now is, as I said, is at the level of, what was it, 10 to minus 15, okay? 10 to minus 15, so, if this means that let's make the measurement, you have in 1 milli, okay, first of all, you cannot, as I said, you cannot get 1 kilogram of material, okay? So yes, you have to count how many nuclei you have in 1 milligram. Hmm? So typically 1 milligram is contains much less than an Avogadro number or nuclei, and having a sensitivity of 10 to minus 15 means that you are able to spot the decays for 100,000 of 10,000 of this carbon 14 atoms. So the problem is that the decay time counts, so they don't decay all at the same time, so you have to take time to measure it. Purification of the sample is another very complex task, because of course you have to extract something that you want to measure from that 1 milligram. I think that the limitation today is not in the sensitivity of the instrument that measures the number of decays of the mass spectrometry, okay? I think that the issue is more on how to prepare the sample, on the fact that you have to work with samples that are so tiny. And there is another point that, as I said, I don't think it's important to date with small precision something which is 50,000 years old, it might be 55,000 years old. That is not the issue to date. I mean, what has been the goal of the carbon 14 measurement? I think the carbon 14 measurement is still mostly devoted to archaeological studies, okay? And there I think that the sensitivity in the order of 10 years, 15 years, I think that is acceptable, okay? I think that sometimes you can do better, but while deciding whether something comes from, let's say, I make an example in Italy, an example that is important in Italy, it might be relevant elsewhere. Something that comes from a city that was at a point was Etruscan and then became Roman, okay? So you have a pottery and you want to decide whether this was done before that the Romans get into that city or after, then that can be relevant to have a good measurement with 10 years precisions. But something that happened 10,000 years ago, I really don't think that having a 10-year precision doesn't make any sense. So the technique is very well adapted to what the goal are. Of course, we are physicists, so we struggle to get a better sensitivity. We will get probably factor 10 better sensitivity. But my impression is that will help more in having a more precision for rather recent samples than that for the past. As I said, the other big thing is in dating objects is in solving the issue whether one bone belonged to what kind of homo, I don't know what, but that is something that 1 million year ago or 500,000 years ago, and that's beyond the hope of carbon 14, that you should use other techniques. So, but I mean, I'm not, of course, the major expert in the field, so I guess that people are working hard to get better precision. But it looks very much adequate to what you do. Certainly, you might be able to measure more things if you convince the owner of the sample that you can do with much less than 1 milligram. But that I think would help. But I think the best message in improving the sensitivity is in reducing the mass of the sample. People are reluctant to cut away a piece of something, even if so.
There is another question from Fabien. Fabien, can you talk?
Then you have to unmute yeah. Again.
Yes, Prof, I can speak.
Go ahead.
Yes.
Please, Prof, about this technology, what are the benefits in the in situ nuclear gamma spectrometry, for example, please, Professor?
Sorry, I didn't get the question. Which technique, the carbon?
Yes, if we can use it in nuclear in situ gamma spectrometry.
No, but this is, here you have only to measure the decay product of the carbon 14, right?
Yes, Professor.
So, I mean, it's only question of, but this is a normal counter, okay? This is a normal counter for spectroscopy. There is nothing on that side. I don't think you have any improvement. I mean, counters for spectroscopy are already extremely good. So I don't think that here you have to pay any attention to the detectors, okay? The limit is certainly not the detector, okay? Because you have an electron, the decay product is 156 kV electron that you can measure with precision. That's not the issue. So I think that the issue is in getting enough. I think it's in getting enough decays in the time you can spend in measurement. I remind you that the half-life of carbon is 5,500 actually years, 5,700 years. So, and the natural concentration is one part in 10 to minus 9. So you have to cope with these two numbers for, so now you can count how many carbon, and it's a nice exercise for all of you. You can count how many carbon 14 atoms you have, nuclei, you have in 1 milligram of, in one, of a sample, which actually the sample is not made only by carbon. So the carbon is one component of the sample. And in fact, in the preparation, you have to extract the carbon if you want to be more precise, if you don't want to wash your measurement in contaminating with other things. So you can count how many atom carbon you had at the beginning of the life, then you have 5,000 years decay time. So you can count how many atoms are left after 50,000 years. And I think you get easily convinced that probably that is the limit. Unless, of course, you can process 1 kilogram of something.
Other questions, other comments?
Yes, Prof, I have a question.
Okay.
Please, Prof, how can we evaluate the background in this technology, please, Professor?
The carbon?
Yes, during the measurement with the 14
the energy resolution, the energy resolution of your detector.
No, you measure a line.
You measure a line, no?
Yes, Prof. The background. For example, natural background during the measurement in the block that in the spectral.
No, no. I see your point. So, I mean, first of all, you can shield, of course, your sample, protecting it by a proper case of lead or any other. Shield you want, but they, at the very end, the dominant thing is the energy resolution on 156 kV electron. So if you can be 1 per mil precise, or 1% precise, or 10% precise, that will determine the background. There is nothing else. I guess that the measurement is done with germanium, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the energy resolution will limit your background. After all, you have to count to have a certain number of counts above a flat background, whatever it means. No, mm-hmm. One of the things that you can do, of course, is that if you in the purification of the sample, if you eliminate everything that is not carbon, that helps a lot because the other components also can produce some background. So you can protect things from natural radiation and you have to have energy resolution. From this point of view, it's a standard, it's a sort of standard technique. It's like when you do an experiment, a precision experiment in underground, you know, if you do dark matter or double beta or things like that, you want to protect your measurement from natural background. There are techniques that are known. There are shieldings and other things, no?
Yeah. Okay, so are there any other questions, comments? Is it clear to everybody how we can use our nuclear physics, high energy physics, applications in many other domains, and this is one one example, and I think we can see how powerful it is and how our studies can extend to other areas. More questions or comments?
Please, Prof, I have another question.
Okay.
In medical physics, for example, at the hospital, how can we use it, please, Professor?
Next week.
Yeah, so...
Next week.
Yeah, Professor Ferroni has another lecture next week, exactly at the same time, where he will describe the applications of nuclear physics technique
to medicine.
Medicine. So you should come back next week and then discuss at that point the medical questions.
In a sense, Fabien, is medicine is an easier field where to apply, because here essentially you are limited to this radioactive decays and to this irradiation with protons or alpha particles. In medicine, it's an immense field of application, and you have many different processes in high energy or low energy or nuclear physics that can be beneficial to medicine. So it's a much varied sector of application. You will see next week some of them.
Other questions or other comments? Fernando, I think maybe page 19, when they tested, the Guggenheim Museum study, the result of that. So I think the study concluded that Léger could not have done the painting.
No, because the canvas was produced after.
Yes. So then, but the results suggested three possible dates when it would have been faked.
On that, you cannot do anything.
Okay.
Cannot do anything because there has been, I think, there's been a peak of explosion, and then probably for 1-2 years. Russians and Americans concentrated on getting bombs of higher potential, and then started to launch them. As far as I remember, the biggest bomb, no, you remember this was called the Tsar bomb, I think, from Russia, was I'll just check. Was detonated in 61.
Mm-hmm.
So you see here in 61 is the restart of the big explosions.
Mm-hmm.
And then for a couple of years there were a lot of them, but then I think in 2 years they decided to stop, mm-hmm. because it was becoming a bit annoying, to say.
Hmm.
But this makes this ambiguity at the level of 130 something concentration,
mm-hmm.
which you cannot do much. Now, one thing that I know that is used, but it's a bit expensive and probably not worth it, except that if something want to sell you, okay, a $10,000 bottle of wine, Bourgogne or whatever, then it might be, saying that it's 1940 or 1950 or 1920, then probably it's worth, before buying, it's worth to ask for a carbon analysis, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Because then if it is higher than 98 was the level, then it was bottled after 1955. Okay.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's it's worth doing on a $10 bottle, right?
Sure. Other questions? Other comments? Okay, so I think if we don't have questions or comments, we can stop for today. So like I said, Professor Ferroni has another lecture next week where he will describe the application of nuclear physics technologies to medicine. So that should be very interesting. So I expect that all of you will come back. Is there a question? I think I see something in the chat. Let me just see. No, there's no question. All right, no, so.
I've seen in the chat that there is nothing else which is a little bit left over. Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much for all of you. It's been a pleasure. Okay.
Thank you, Fernando. So see you next week.
Okay.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye. Ketevi, the next lecture will be at the same time?
It will be at the same time, yes.
Okay, great.
Yeah. Thank you.
Ciao.
Bye.
Bye.